Well, full disclosure requires that I reveal that I love British Airways. So I'm not sure that I'm the right person to follow on to John's rather gloomy remarks. I personally spent $83,000 on buying airline tickets from British Airways last year. And I have every intention of continuing to do so.
Yes,
so
sir.
Let it not go away. Right. Now, in some ways, I'm quite the wrong person to come and talk to you. A conductor of an orchestra is the last bastion of totalitarianism left in the civilized world. If we are going to address the issues that John brought up, leadership is the name of the game. That's what we're going to be talking about today, leadership. And is the conductor really the person to ask? Because after all, a conductor stands on a podium. He has in front of him an orchestra of 100 musicians. Recently, I performed in Carnegie Hall, the Mahler's Eighth Symphony. I had 412 musicians in front of me. And choirs and children's choirs and brass and soloists and an orchestra of 120, and everybody has to obey me. Okay. And in fact, it may not be known to you, but an orchestra player is not allowed to speak directly to the conductor except in the form of a question. Because after all, how can you add to the knowledge of an omniscient being? There was a study done a few years ago at Harvard University. They took 12 professions, and they discovered that orchestra players came just below prison guards in terms of their job satisfaction. Whereas chamber music players, the musicians who play in small groups, came out number one. And the only difference between chamber music players and orchestra players, apart, of course, the numbers, is the presence of a conductor. So we're going to look at this character, the conductor. There are lots of stories about conductors, mostly told by orchestra players. And one of my favorite is the one about Toscanini, who was a famous conductor, and he had a legendary temper. And in the middle of a rehearsal, apparently, he became exasperated with one of the players, one of the double bass players, and he shouted, "You're fired!" at this poor man. Well, the man began to pack up his instrument. He was, after all, going home to tell his wife that he didn't have a job after 20 years. And as he left the room for the last time, he turned around and he shouted at Toscanini, "You're a no-good son of a bitch!" And Toscanini shouted back, "It's too late to apologize." Now, what you have there is the hierarchical, top-down, right-thinking, male style of leadership that has served humanity for about 50,000 years. And I think everybody in this room knows that it's no longer adequate for what we're up to. I had addressed a group of about 60 young leaders, 20-year-olds, last week in New York at the State of the World Forum, and I said to them, the next 35 years are going to be the most exciting 35 years in human history. The question is, what world do we want? And who do we have to be for the journey? Now, I'm going to begin here, because BA is a great company, and I have no criticism of BA, but all these seats are empty, which is really interesting. And if it were not for the fact that somebody brought influence to bear on these people here, these seats would be empty too. Whereas all the seats at the back are filled. I once gave a talk at Walt Disney, and the first 5 rows were empty. However, all the back seats were filled, and so I went to the back and gave my talk at the back. Now, what is it about the back row seats that are so irresistible? What is it about the back row that people love so much? Tell me, what is it? Sorry, what was that? Well, that's not really the case. Think about it. Why do people sit at the back? They can see everybody. That's right. That's one of the reasons people sit at the back. People at the back are often sitting up there saying, they're having a little trouble in the front. often with their arms crossed like that. And yes, that's right. The critics and the judges sit in the back. Good. What else about the back? What's that? Sight.
Safe.
It's safe. Exactly. It's safe. Nobody will call on you if you're in the back. It's a wonderful place to hide. What else about the back? No. Not at all. Not at all. Think about it. What about the back? What else? It's near the door so you can escape. It's a wonderful place to escape from. Good. What else can you do in the back? You can sleep. See, I have a friend who teaches a course in philosophy. They meet at 8 o'clock in the morning. There are 50 people in the class. 30 of them are in the back sleeping, he says. 20 of them are in the front. He has a great conversation with the 20 in the front. And he finds that completely normal. Now, I conduct a symphony orchestra. I can't afford to have 30 of my musicians asleep. So now, what is the front for? Who is the front for? Who are these seats actually for? You can't imagine the dance you went through not to sit here. I mean, these two guys, you know, they came in here and they moved these chairs and they said, how can we get, and they, anywhere they would sit. But, and there was one person who actually came down and sat here for a while and then moved. Who are the seats? Yes, dignitaries. It's the VIPs. It's the important people, you see. I gave a talk last year in America for the Fortune 500 presidents. There were 180 of them in the room. Do you know how many of them sat in the front row? None of them. That's for the important people. Now, we've actually distinguished something in this room. We've distinguished the back row. We've distinguished the front row. So I would like everybody who's in the back row actually to leave your seat and come right in the front. I mean, there are about 12 seats here. Look at the seats there. Wonderful. Thank you. Great. Wonderful. There we go, down there. Yeah, makes all the difference. Yeah. For the rest of your life, incidentally, every time you go into a room from now on, you'll be able to decide whether you sit in the back or the front. This is now distinguished forever.